Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. K. Saraboji from Department of Bioinformatics, School of Chemical and Biotechnology, Sastra University, Tanjavur, Tamil Nadu. Today, we are going to talk on module Protein Secondary Structure Prediction from paper Bioinformatics. First, let us see what we are going to learn from this module. What are protein secondary structure? Protein secondary structures, the importance of secondary structure and its prediction, accuracy measure of predicting methods, first, second and third generation secondary structure prediction method, consensus prediction method, combining multiple secondary structure prediction method, and predicting special kind of secondary structure, and finally, the quality assessment in secondary structure prediction methods. First, let us see. Protein structure prediction is the prediction of the three-dimensional structure of a protein from its amino acid sequence. That is, prediction of spatial position of each atom in the tertiary structure generated from only the sequence knowledge. So, the secondary structure prediction aims to predict the secondary structure from its primary structure. That is, it is the first step towards three-dimensional structure prediction. Different approaches were developed to predict the secondary structure, and they are based on various approaches. And here we are going to explore how the secondary structure prediction methods were evolved since 1970s. Proteins are polymers of amino acids covalently linked through peptide bonds into a linear chain. This is called the primary structure, which undergo the folding process which forms the matured protein molecule. The secondary structure refers to local folded structures that form within the polypeptide due to interaction between backbone atoms. The most common types of secondary structures are the alpha helices and beta sheets. Linnaeus Pauling first proposed these secondary structures in 1951. These secondary structures are defined by patterns of hydrogen bonds between the main chain peptide groups. Tertiary structures refers to overall three-dimensional structure of polypeptide in the compact monomeric state. That is, the alpha helices and beta sheets are folded into compact globular structure which gets stabilized by specific covalent and non-covalent interactions. Many proteins are made up of a single polypeptide chain and have only three levels of structure, the ones we have discussed. However, some proteins are made up of multiple polypeptide chains known as subunits. When these subunits come together, they give the protein the quaternary structure. Remember that many proteins contain both alpha helices and beta sheets as the building blocks, and these secondary structure elements are essential determinants of protein fold and the tertiary structure. The secondary structures, alpha helices and beta sheets, are ordered and repetitive structures. In a polypeptide chain, the main chain NC alpha and C alpha C bonds are relatively free to rotate. These rotations are represented by the torsion angles phi and psi respectively. These two torsion angles in the polypeptide chain, also called Ramachandran angles, define constraints to form the stable secondary structures, such as the parallel, antiparallel beta sheets, left and right-handed helices. Besides, the Ramachandran plot is used in evaluating the quality of experimental structures or homology models. Understand that the Ramachandran plot can be useful to assign the secondary structure if you have the atomic positions. So before that, it is important to discuss why we have to focus on protein secondary structures. So we know that functional aspect of proteins are also reflected in the secondary structure, and occasionally the function can be derived from the secondary structure alone. So there are four main uses of secondary structure. Basically, it is the inductive of the fold or the fold class, the secondary structure that dictates the specific three-dimensional fold, and also it influences the sequence alignment. So even two sequences, they are far away, the secondary structural information can help us to identify the we can use the secondary structural information to get the better correlation between two sequences. And the secondary structural information is more closely related with function, and it is the spontaneous means of visualizing protein three-dimensional structures. Before start to study the structure prediction methods, it is important to know the difference between experimental structure determination and structure prediction. To experimentally determine the three-dimensional structure, we can use X-ray crystallography, which provides molecular structure at the atomic level, or NMR spectroscopy, which gives the dynamic behavior of the molecule in addition to the three-dimensional structure. Or we can use electron microscopy, by which we can explore the structures of huge molecular assemblies, complex structures. These methods are commonly used by structural biologists to study the macromolecular structures. However, each method has its own constraints in terms of sample preparation, resolution limits, and the molecular size. To compensate the technical difficulties of this method and to speed up the process of looking 3D structures, computational methods were developed to predict the three-dimensional structure of proteins. Presently, three approaches are followed for the prediction of the tertiary structure of proteins. The first one is homology modeling, which assumes similar sequences tend to fold into similar structures and uses previously solved structures as template to build the model of given sequence. The second one is the fold recognition, or what we call it as threading, which is used to model the proteins which have the same fold as proteins of known structures but do not have homologous proteins with the known structure. The third and final one is ab initio structure prediction, which assumes that the native structure of protein is at the global free energy minimum. So a large-scale conformational search is required to locate the possible minimum free energy state for the given amino acid sequence. Keep in mind that these prediction methods requires a continuous improvement to increase the accuracy of prediction to match with the experimental observations. Towards the goal of three-dimensional structure prediction, secondary structure prediction aims to predict the secondary structures of protein sequences based on only the knowledge from the primary structure. That is, predicting secondary structure for every amino acid in the sequence, such as helix, strand, loop, turn, and coil. The fundamental assumption of most of the secondary structure prediction method is that there should be a correlation between the amino acid sequence and the secondary structure. That is, the entire information for forming secondary structure is contained in the primary sequence. So many algorithms examine the sequence window of 13 to 17 residues, assuming that the central amino acid in the window will adopt a conformation that is determined by the side groups of all the amino acids in the window. The algorithms use different sequence window sizes. For alpha helices, the window is typically 5 to 40 residues long, and for beta strands, the window ranges from 5 to 10 residues in length. Earlier algorithms assumed that each amino acid within the sequence window was not affected by neighboring amino acid, but later methods accounted the influence of such a neighboring amino acids and possibility of more distinct interactions in their methodology.
Why the secondary structure prediction?
why we have to focus more on secondary structure prediction. In principle, it is an easier problem than three-dimensional structure prediction. And more than 40 years, we are trying to, we are aiming to predict the three-dimensional structure. And the earlier approaches primarily focus on developing methods to predict the secondary structure alone. And the using the secondary structure prediction method, we can able to predict the fold or fold class, something like either it's alpha class or all alpha class, all beta class, or alpha plus beta class, or alpha mixer class, something like alpha slash beta, or which has more of irregular shapes. And secondary structures are often the first step towards the three-dimensional structure prediction, as we discussed. And the predicted structures can be used in structure-based drug discovery process, and it can help us to understand the effects of mutation on the specific structure and to understand the changes in the function as well. And the secondary structure prediction method used to detect the domain boundaries within proteins with remote sequence homology. Secondary structure segments speed up the large-scale alignment of three-dimensional structures. And the relevance of secondary structure explains why secondary structure prediction from sequence has become one of the most interesting tasks in bioinformatics. The most accurate structural characterization of protein is provided by X-ray crystallography and NMR spectroscopy. Owing to the technical difficulties and labor intensiveness of these methods, number of protein structures solved by experimental method lags far behind than the accumulation of protein sequences. Here you can see the recent size of the sequence and structural databases. There are 1.24 lakhs protein structures deposited in protein data bank, which includes the redundant structures such as mutant forms, designed proteins. From this, we can clearly see that even the redundant PDB entries accounted for just less than 1% of available sequences in the UniProt database. The gap between the number of protein sequences and the number of structures has been increasing continuously. So, the experimental methods alone are not sufficient to fill the sequence structure gap. This scenario signifies the urgent need of developing structure prediction methods. Now we discuss the evaluation of accuracies of the secondary structure prediction methods. The most common accuracy measure is Q3 score. The Q3 score is the average of each Q values measured individually for helix, sheet, and coil states, where Q values are defined as the percentage of correctly predicted residues in the particular state to the total number of experimentally observed residues in that state. The best prediction methods currently have Q3 scores between 70 to 80%. But it is very important to aware that the Q3 score can give an over-optimistic estimate of accuracy than expected, because the number of residues in helices, strands, and loops in the database are not evenly distributed. Also, Q3 score focuses on per residue accuracy and not evaluate the overall picture of how predicted secondary structural elements are correctly positioned across the sequence. For example, if you predict every residue in a helix-dominated sequence like hemoglobin to adapt a helical conformation with an accuracy of 80%. But this number is uninformative prediction. It is not very useful in understanding the overall topology of this protein. So, alternatively, we can use another accuracy measure known as segment overlap measure, which is abbreviated as SOV. It measures the extent to which the predicted segment of a particular secondary structure state is identical to the experimentally observed structure. SOV measures individually for helix, strand, and loop states, and SOV3 score is taken as the average of these three individual SOV scores.
To predict the secondary structure for every amino acid in the sequence, various computational methods were developed since late 1960s. Based on the strategy, the prediction algorithms were classified into three categories or three generations. The methods developed in 1970s are called as first generation methods, which are based on single residue statistics. The most classical structure predictors, Chavan-Fassman, GOR1, are the examples of these methods, which are constrained to the accuracy range in between 50 to 55%. The second generation were developed in 1980s based on segment statistics. The principal improvement of the second generation of prediction tools was a combination of larger database of protein structure and use of the statistics based on the segments. GOR3 and ALB method are examples of this kind of strategy. The accuracy levels slightly increased than the first generation method in second generation procedures. The last procedure, which utilizes evolution data through multiple sequence alignments and machine learning approaches, are classified as third generation methods. The accuracy of third generation methods improved to 80%. PhD, CyPred, JPred algorithms were developed based on this approach. The Chavan-Fassman method is an empirical technique for the prediction of secondary structure developed in the 1970s by Chow and Fassman. The method is based on the analysis of relative frequencies of each amino acid in alpha helix, beta sheet and turns based on known protein structure solved with X-ray crystallography. From these frequencies, a set of probability parameters were derived for the appearance of each amino acid in each secondary structure type, and these parameters are used to predict the probability that a given sequence of amino acid would form a helix or a beta sheet or a turn in the protein sequence. For example, in a database of 2000 amino acids, consider there are 100 alanines. If we took at the helix forming residues in particular, consider there are 500 residues in which 50 of them are alanines. The propensity of alanine to be in helix can be obtained as the ratio between the frequency of alanine in a helix to the frequency of total alanines, as shown here. Here, the propensity value 2 indicates that alanine is a good helix former. The original Chow and Fassman parameters found some strong tendencies among the individual amino acids to prefer one type of secondary structure over others. In such a way, their preferences was classified as strong former, strong breaker, weak breaker, and indifferent. Glutamate, methionine, alanine, and leucine were identified as helix former, and due to the unique conformational properties of their peptide bonds, proline and glycine are common helix breakers. Similarly, valine, isoleucine, tyrosine are strong beta strand formers, whereas aspartic acid, glutamic acid break the strands. The Chavan-Fassman method predicts helix and strands in a similar fashion. It first performs search linearly through the sequence for a nucleation region of high helix or strand probability, and then extending the region until a subsequent four residue window criteria, a probability of less than 1. If the score greater than or 4, found out any 6 adjacent amino acid were sufficient to nucleate a helix, and the score greater than or equal to 3 out of any adjacent 5 were sufficient for a sheet. Here the sequence showed in the figure favors the nucleation to form a strand with the nucleation at valine with the score 4.5. The original Chavan-Fassman parameters were derived from very small and non-representative sample of protein structures due to the small number of structural entries available in PDB by the time of their original work. So these original parameters have been updated from the latest dataset. The method is at most about 50 to 60% accurate in identifying correct secondary structures, which is significantly less accurate than the modern techniques.
Let us see how second generation methods works. So it is similar to single residue methods, but the principal improvement of the second generation of prediction tools was the combination of large database of protein structures and the use of statistics based on the segments, typically of 11 to 21 adjacent residues. So the GAR method, which was developed in 1978 and still it has the continuous development. So the GAR method was developed by three scientists, Garnier, Ostrop and Robson. So which is an information theory based method utilizing powerful probabilistic techniques of Bayesian interface. This method has been improved by including larger databases and more detailed statistics, which accounts not only for amino acid composition, but also amino acid pairs and triplets, which was implemented in the recent GAR 4 procedure. And the GAR procedure used position-dependent propensities per helix, sheet and turn, which was calculated for each amino acids. For each position in J in the sequence, 8 residues on either sides were calculated. A helix propensity table was contains information about the propensity for residues at 17 position when the conformation of the residue J is a helical. So the helix propensity table, according to the GAR procedure, which can have 20 by 17 entries. So such a similar tables can be derived for helices, strands and coil separately. So according to this procedure, GAR 4 method can predict the protein secondary structures with the accuracy of 65%.
Here we can see the table showing the conformation propensity for alpha helix, which has 20 by 17 entries. Note that the predicted conformational state, helix, strand or turn at a position J is calculated as the sum of position dependent propensities of all the residues in the window of 17 residues around J. The GAR method is well suited for programming and was standard method for many years.
So in second generation structure prediction methods, so the algorithms utilized many different, variety of information. For example, these algorithms are based on statistical information, physicochemical properties, sequence patterns, and multi-layer networks, and multivariate statistics, expert rules, and nearest neighbor algorithms. So the second and first and second generation prediction methods have some advantages as well as certain drawbacks. So these first and second generation structure prediction methods shared at least two of the following problems. The first one is the three-state per residue accuracy, what we call it as Q3, which is always lesser than 70%. It because the secondary structure formation is partially determined by long-range interactions, which are not at all inferred in the segments of 11 to 21 adjacent residues. And the second one is beta strands were predicted at less than 50% of accuracy, that is only slightly better than the random prediction. So it is because the beta sheets formation is determined by more non-local contacts than the alpha helical formation. And the third one is the predicted helices and strands were too short from in the first and second generation prediction procedures.
The secondary structure methods made a significant improvement by considering evolutionary information. It is well known that protein structure is more conserved than protein sequence. And the two sequences that share more than 35% sequence identity are likely to have similar structures. So, when predicting the secondary structure of a particular protein sequence, predictions for its homologs may also get useful. Furthermore, multiple alignments of sequence families indirectly provide the information about long-range interactions. The residue substitution patterns observed between the proteins of a particular structural family are highly specific for the structure of that family. The third generation methods were developed by incorporating evolutionary information into the basic secondary structure prediction methods, results and improved the performance. Later, some special features of neural nets that makes them particularly well suited to predicting secondary structures. This is the approach taken by Rost and Sander in 1990s, and their neural network based program was the first to go beyond 70% of three-state accuracy. The use of evolutionary information is critical for the improved performance, and all modern approaches use evolutionary information in making secondary structure predictions. In addition to secondary structure, some programs predict the solvent accessibility of the residues, suggest the location of secondary structure in the three-dimensional structure of proteins. Here we will see the principal concepts of third generation methods. Using neural network based method PHT, because it is currently the most accurate method, and most of the other third generation methods uses this as the base procedure. The schematic pipeline which implements the evolutionary information to predict secondary structure in PHT algorithm is shown here. Starting from a sequence of unknown structure, the following steps are used to finally feed the evolutionary information into the PHD neural networks. First, a sequence of unknown structure is quickly aligned against the database of known sequences like BLAST, for which no information of structure is required. Then, the proteins with sufficient sequence identity to assure structural similarity are extracted and realigned using multiple alignment algorithm MaxHome, which works based on profile-based dynamic programming. Then, these alignments were taken to screen the correct homologous based on length-dependent cutoff for pairwise sequence identity. For each position, the profile of residue exchanges in the final multiple alignment is completed and used as input to a neural network. PHD processes the input information on multiple levels. The first level is a feed-forward neural network with three layers of units: the input layer, hidden layer, and output layer. The input layer is the first level, in which is a sequence to structure network, consists of two contributions, one from the local sequence and another from the global sequence. The second level is a structure to structure network. The third level consists of an arithmetic average of independently trained networks, and the final level is the simple filter. PHT rates at an average accuracy of about 72%. CyPRED is CyBLAST based secondary structure prediction method. It uses two-stage neural network based on the position-specific scoring matrices generated by CyBLAST instead of simple BLAST used in PHT method. The bar graph shown here is the comparison of prediction results for CASP3 targets by CyPRED and two other popular methods, JPRED, which is a PHT-based method, and DSE. CyPRED improves the accuracy significantly compared to PHT method. The average Q3 score are found in the ranges of 76.5 to 78.3%. Interestingly, the latest version of CyPRED can reach the accuracy of 81.6% for the specific data set. Support vector machine represents a new approach for supervised pattern classification used to predict the secondary structure from multiple alignments with better accuracy. It works based on the construction of several binary classifiers and then assembly of tertiary classifier for three secondary structure states, helix, sheet, and coil, based on these binary classifiers. Here you can see the structures of one of the tertiary classifier made up of two cascaded binary classifiers. For example, the sample will be classified as helix if the output of the first binary classifier labeled as H or intended to be H is larger than 0. Otherwise, the second classifier labeled as E or C will be used. If the output of E or C is larger than 0, then the sample will be classified as sheet, otherwise coil will be assigned. The SVM method achieves a good performance of segment overlap accuracy 76.2% with the Q3 score of 73.5%. The recent studies show that the structure prediction method based on SVM with position specific scoring matrix profiles generated by SciBlast achieves the segment overlap accuracy in the range of 81.8 to 82.8%. As a new dimension, the secondary structure prediction methods uses consensus results from the combination of methods instead of using single method. JPRED is such a consensus secondary structure prediction method which derives prediction using different heuristics based on nearest neighbors, jury decision neural networks, linear discrimination, consensus single sequence method combination, hydrogen bond propensities, and conservation number weighted predictions. It should be noted that they are the current state of art secondary structure prediction method that exploit the evolutionary information from multiple sequences. This method results in average accuracy, the Q3 accuracy to 73%. The JPRED protein secondary structure prediction method was developed by Barton and co-workers in 1998 and still has continuous updates, and the present version of JPRED 4 is available as an online server. Combining multiple secondary structure prediction methods can improve the prediction accuracy because non-systematic errors can be removed by correctly combining them. Here we can see some of the attempts of such kind. A simple consensus prediction using linear discrimination, PHD, nearest neighborhood method, and predictor, which works based on hydrogen bonding propensities, shows the improvement of prediction accuracy. Interestingly, the latest GOR 5 algorithm combines with information theory, Bayesian statistics, and evolutionary information, which reached an accuracy of prediction to 73.5%. In other study, the consensus data mining combining GOR 5 and fragment database mining results the Q3 score in the range of 65.5 to 93%. In addition, several studies which involve structure-based sequence alignment with traditional sequence-based secondary structure methods provides better prediction accuracy. Consensus of different programs including PHD, GOR4, based on a mixed integer linear optimization provides a significant improvement on accuracy for the own data set in Cas9 experiment. CSSP is a consensus-based secondary structure prediction workbench developed by scientists at Indian Institute of Science, shows improved in accuracy than other methods. Secondary structure formation also depends on many other factors. The prediction methods found improved by addition of these parameters. For example, several recent secondary structure prediction algorithms utilizes the local environment
the information about the solvent accessibility of the residues and protein structural class and long-range contacts, organism from which the proteins are obtained. And there are some methods which primarily works based on the first principle procedures that predicts the secondary structure by minimizing the free energy.
The folding of membrane protein is different from globular proteins. So, special efforts have been taken to predict the transmembrane proteins because of their biological importance and overcome the barrier in determining its three-dimensional structure using X-ray crystallography. It is commonly believed that the prediction of structures simpler for membrane proteins than for globular ones, as the lipid bilayer impose a strong constraint on the degrees of freedom of structures such as hydrophobicity. The transmembrane region prediction methods are broadly based on a hydrophobicity analysis such as using Keitel-Doolittle plots. The plot shown here, the x-axis is the window size, y-axis is the hydrophobicity score. If the hydrophobic score greater than 1.8 in 19 amino acid window indicate possible transmembrane, and strong negative peaks in 9 amino acid window indicate possible surface region of the globular proteins. In addition to this, transmembrane helices in integral membrane proteins are composed of stretches of 15 to 30 predominantly hydrophobic residues separated by connecting loops with positive inside rule. Number of algorithms based on hydrophobic plots, threading, hidden Markov model, machine learning and neural networks have been designed to identify transmembrane helices and beta sheets. The current methods can identify approximately 90 to 95% of true membrane segments. In contrast to predict the folded state of protein structure, prediction of intrinsically disordered protein is a challenging task. The intrinsically disordered proteins are natively unstructured and have many different conformations. That is, it don't possess the stable secondary or tertiary structure under physiological condition until it binds to the specific binding partner. Even the disordered proteins lack stable structure, they are functionally important class of proteins due to their frequent involvement in protein-protein interactions. Surprisingly, disordered regions in proteins are often contain short linear peptide motifs and sometimes as large as the entire domains. The disordered regions are often rich in polar uncharged amino acids with low sequence complexity and high sequence variability, which does not allow sufficient favorable interactions to fold them. Due to these facts, the usual secondary structure prediction methods predict the intrinsically disordered proteins with low predicted secondary structure content.
As we have seen, predicting the intrinsically disordered regions are trickier than predicting the normal protein. So, the disorder structure prediction utilizes different approaches like amino acid composition, sequence complexity, hydrophobicity, charge, and some utilizes the combination of secondary structure and solvent accessibility information. Some procedures operates based on neural networks, and some intrinsically disordered predictor algorithms were trained on the experimental data, where some of them are ab initio in nature. Ponder, slider, SIG, fold index, MFD, spine, dis-EMBL are some of the most popular intrinsically disordered predicting algorithms. And most programs are better at predicting the order than the disordered region. For example, these algorithms can predict the ordered region with 80% of accuracy, whereas the disordered prediction accuracy falls down below 60%. And some methods are better for predicting the short region and other for a longer segment. So it's always advised to use the combination of these algorithms to get the better intrinsically, the better prediction of intrinsically disordered region.
Based on the topics which we have seen so far, I hope you got the impression that there are many different programs available with different procedures with variable efficiency. Most of them are completely automated programs which are available online for free, and some of them requires license and run locally in your computers. Here is the list of popular secondary structure prediction programs and web links for access. So as I mentioned already, you can use more than one method to get the concurrence in your results. In addition to learning the various procedures and programs for predicting secondary structures, we need to be aware of certain drawbacks and ways to overcome it by carefully analyzing the results. For example, the most accurate method predicts the secondary structure with 75% accuracy. When interpreting prediction for a particular protein, it is often useful to mark the 25% of the residues you suspect to be falsely predicted. On the other hand, we should understand that the expected accuracy of 70% does not imply that it's for your protein alone. In fact, the 70% was obtained by averaged over hundreds of unique proteins. So there are many chances to predict your sequence with more than 80% or less than 60% accuracy. Also, the choice of structure predicting procedures is also important to obtain a good reliable results. For example, the special classes of proteins such as transmembrane helices, disordered proteins always requires a special program to deal with. We know that multiple alignment based predictions are substantially more accurate than single sequence based predictions. But we don't have a generalized rule to keep so many sequences in our alignment for an improvement. More importantly, we should be aware that the primary structure may or may not be sufficient to predict the three-dimensional structure. That is, the same secondary structure pattern may or may not have a similar fold. Several community-wide benchmarking experiments are performed to assess the quality of secondary structure prediction programs and identify the best performing method for our target. CASP is Critical Assessment of Protein Structure Prediction. It is a community-wide experiment for protein structure prediction taking place every 2 years since 1994. CASP provides with an opportunity to assess the quality of available automated, semi-automated, and manual programs. CVASP deals critical assessment of fully automated structure prediction methods, runs once in 2 years in parallel with CASP programs. Both CASP and CVASP are conducted in a double-blind fashion. In contrast to CASP and CVASP, EVA is an automated secondary structure assessment server that evaluates the performance of several secondary structure prediction servers in a regular manner. But EVA can only evaluate prediction techniques that are automated in the form of servers. LiveBench is another popular benchmarking system which do the large-scale continuous assessment of automated protein structure prediction programs.
So, students, let's now summarize what we have learned in this module. We learned that the knowledge of protein secondary structure content is very essential to study the fold, biological function, and enhancing the structure alignment, etc. So the prediction of protein secondary structure from the sequence have evolved since 1970s, and earlier pioneering methods utilized simple rules based on single residue statistics. The main reason for the increased accuracy in predicting secondary structure in the model methods due to the incorporation of evolutionary information. The sophisticated knowledge-based approaches such as which utilizing neural network based methods and support vector machine, increases the Q3 scores in the range from 74% to 80%. And consensus result from combining the multiple methods always improves the accuracy significantly, and which was recommended most of the time. The segments such as intrinsically disordered region, transmembrane region, and the coil regions always need a special attention, and we may need to use these kind of programs to detect the special features present in the amino acid sequence. So finally, the quality assessment programs that can suggest the best performing structure prediction techniques. Thank you.